What's going on, comrades? Drewski and James here, and we just got back from seeing Kong Skull Island, and we're going to let you know what we thought about it. So I guess this is just going to be a general review, go over the plot, and then tell you guys how we thought, or what we thought about the movie, and if we liked it, because I can remove the glasses now. But yeah, so I'll say there's not many spoilers to this movie, really. It's more of a thriller enjoying, in the moment, action movie. Not much to spoil.
Not a huge amount of plot points.
Right. It's
kind of a streamline.
It's basic, so skip ahead like 30 seconds if you're really like crazy about it. But the only real spoiler is Kong doesn't die. And that's the main question I'm pretty sure most people have. And Kong doesn't die, but we'll explain it and what that means as we talk about the plot. So, I guess first thing is the main question to be asked is, did we enjoy it? And I'll start off by saying I'm not like the biggest Kong connoisseur of knowledge. I've seen the 1937 version once, like a couple years back when I was getting into like classic horror and Universal movies and stuff like that. And I've seen the Peter Jackson one in theaters. Just recently rewatched that today. I don't know, which ones have you seen?
I've seen all of them, basically. The early one, like the 1937, the old-fashioned classic version, and then a few of the Japanese ones for shits and giggles I've seen.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Those are actually trippy.
Yeah. And then the modern remake they made.
Okay. So, pretty much, we're going into it, both of us, the same level of knowledge, you know. But still, like I said, it's a great reboot to the series, because that's what it is. So I guess we'll just start talking. We both liked it.
Yeah.
That answers the question. We both liked it. Generally good movie.
Especially nowadays with the CGI fest.
Yes.
It had some great shots. It had really good quality, you know, real landscapes, not a huge amount of CGI when it wasn't necessary. None of that unnecessary CGI BS.
So yeah, it was a good, enjoyable, non-hokey movie. So, let's just get into the main plot, I guess. Talk about that real quick.
I find it funny. It kind of, the main plot started off similar with the old Godzilla, the whatever, 1990 or...
The 99 or
91,
whatever.
91 with the whole nuclear test, like, because it starts off with them wanting to get to the island. They discovered it and shit.
Right, yeah, they kind of, like, they hinted at that in the intro. They had, like, a whole World War II to, because that's when the movie started, I guess. The movie started with, and all right, that's a good thing about the movie. A thing I really liked much about it was within the first 10-minute opening scene, you see King Kong.
Yeah,
it starts
no
off
hiding him or
no. Right,
yet.
It's no bullshit. It's like I watched the Peter Jackson one earlier today, and I think it was like an hour or so into the movie. I'll look it up, maybe see how long. But it's like
before you catch a glimpse of him.
Yeah, it's like an hour into a 3-hour movie before you see like King Kong. But anywho, and this one starts out with an Allied pilot, Japanese pilot, going down World War II, and then they're both fighting out because they both survived the crash. During the fight, Kong shows up, and from there on, that's when the movie starts, and, you know, your intro credits are everything. And then you got, it starts in their present time for the movie is 1973, Vietnam, and the waning years of Vietnam, and Nixon and all
pretty
that
much
stuff.
Based immediately off of the end of the Vietnam War.
Yes.
Actually, it starts with the end of the Vietnam War. They're trying this organization. It's like, what was it?
Monarch.
Monarch.
Yeah.
It was like the,
which was John
monster
Goodman
hunting
and his partner.
Yeah, it was the monster hunting a part of the government, and they were about to get pretty much completely defunded. And the end of the war was like their last opportunity to get some soldiers.
They had to pretty
to
much
head to the island.
Bag one of the bureaucratic money men that funds their
senator
ventures.
Was a senator.
Senator, that's who it was. Yeah. So it's similar to the 33 and the more similar to me the Peter Jackson one, because it's kind of like Carl Denham trying to get the producers or whatever to fund him
film.
So he could go just do this one-off crazy adventure. But so yeah, that happens. You know, they assemble their ragtag crew. It's kind of cool. They go to Vietnam and get like this really cool scout. You know, nature
expert tracker.
Yeah, tracker.
Find lost soldiers, and now they're hiring them to help them guide them through
the
jungles.
Yeah, so they get a guide because it's pretty much just like John Goodman and like these scientist guys that
like,
you know,
his
like
sidekick scientist. I can't remember what his name was.
Yeah,
but he was cool. He wasn't really a main character. He was just kind of He didn't die, so I guess he was made enough.
Right. So it's kind of cool.
Then they pick up a few scientists, this one chick, and then this tracker, and then they pick up the Times magazine and, like, war photographer chick. Yeah, the chick.
Photographer chick. And then to take them all there to this remote, unmarked mat, they have to get a military escort. So that's where Samuel Jackson as a colonel comes in.
Yeah.
And his little ragtag group of, you know, former Vietnam veterans and, you know, war heroes. So it's kind of like, I like that because it's...
But there's an immediate hintage of, like, it kind of does play a realistic part in real world because, like, his character, Morgan's...
Samuel Jackson.
Morgan Freeman.
The other Samuel old black
Jackson's
guy.
Character was pissed that the war was ending because he thought he lost, basically. It wasn't,
yeah.
Like, he took personal, I guess... He seemed to take personal, like, anger against the whole fact that the war was ending and he didn't get to do his, like, finish it.
Yeah, he was so kind of the antagonist.
For, yeah, like, angry, yeah, character that's just wants to finish a fight somehow.
Yeah, so, it's...
And you always feel bad because the group that gets conned in, or not conned into it, but deployed is this group that's getting to go home, like, that
right.
day.
Right, it was his last, they were, like, packing up to go, and he gets one final call, like, on the phone from, like, his, you know, from the commanders up, you know, up the ladder or whatever. Like, you know, we got this mission for you, just simple.
You're gonna go map an island.
Yeah, you're mapping an island, take these guys there, and it'll be your last thing, but you don't have to if you don't want to. You don't know your boys are heading home.
That's the other thing we missed, actually, because the only reason this project worked was because another group was going there anyway, and they piggybacked on their project to go and do their science experiments. And then they needed an expert.
So, they go, and it's kind of built up throughout the film. You think, you know, Samuel Jackson's going to do the shit that causes, you know, causes Kong and everything else to go crazy. So, they get to the island...
Oh, wait, we missed so they get on a ship, they're heading towards the island, and then they, like, the island, apparently the reason that nobody's ever gone to it, even though it's 73,
right.
is because there's this massive hurricane-like storm surrounding it.
Yeah, big wall of, like, thundering clouds, and they
finally discovered, like, a gap in it with satellite. That was the other thing, the other president was, like, the big jump in technology was the reason they discovered the island in the first place, was satellites.
This movie was really heavily based in the Vietnam era.
Very.
And
Cold
even
War.
Cold War, Vietnam, that whole... early 70s, and it, like,
conflict.
The music was all spot on, the cinematography, it was like Apocalypse Now and Platoon meets King Kong.
Yeah.
Like, there were so many shots of just, like, the sun, like, big red sun,
coming up,
and, like, helicopters, and just, like, guys walking through the jungle with M60s and M16s.
But,
like, it's all really, like, it's like you're watching a mashup of, like, a historical movie and a monster movie put in one, because the island's also riddled full of these crazy, like, spider monsters.
Bamboo spider leg monster.
Yeah, like a tree trunk bamboo monster. Fucking, like I said, giant spiders. Octopussies.
Oh, God.
The
giant octopus. Yeah, that part was fucking hilarious. I want to talk a little more about that.
Yeah, that was...
In a minute, yeah.
No, that's fine. So, okay, we get to the... Yeah. We're not going to fucking nitpick the whole thing. We'll just talk about major things remembered.
They get through the storm, which was crazy, like...
Right, they
flying,
get through the storm.
Nearly crashing.
And that's the second time, that's the next time you finally see Kong. That's one of the badass shots I remember the most. They got helicopters flying, and then you just see Kong standing in front of the big red sun, just, like, standing there. And it wasn't one of them shitty, like, see around the edges,
like,
half-assed George Lucas CG. Yeah, like, he's standing there, and he looks like he's just a monolith of destruction, like, 100 feet tall. Yeah, and he's, like, 100 feet tall now.
He's huge, yeah. He's definitely a lot bigger than his predecessors.
And, like, this motherfucker's, like, smacking helicopters out of the sky, like, smashing people, like, the gore, not gore, but, like, the violence. For a PG-13 movie, this is pushing it. Like, some of the stuff that happens in this movie, monsters
getting
ripped apart.
They wouldn't have gotten away with it PG-13 when we were kids.
Right.
That was
definitely
R. That was, yeah.
They had to pull some strings on that.
Like, Kong introduces himself. They're flying along. They're all having fun playing Vietnam music out the friggin'...
Yeah.
They got speakers. I kind of found that weird.
They're playing Paranoid by Black Sabbath.
So it's just blasting. And all of a sudden they look forward and there's this tree trunk coming flying.
Oh,
right,
my God.
It impales the friggin' helicopter all the way through and it just crashes. And then, yeah, giant hand smash. He's not nice, but he's not invulnerable. I like it. Like, when he grabbed a tail end, it cut him.
Yeah,
and
he's like,
pissed. He was like, what the shit? And then he just grabs it again, though, and smashes it. And
it was really cool seeing, like, like Kong with modern technology almost.
It was really good, yeah. He looked real. I mean, like, really well done.
That's okay, I guess we could talk about how Kong looks then as a quick interjection.
He doesn't have your typical silverback gorilla build. He is more humanized, a little bit more human statury.
He looks like the Peter Jackson one, but
a little aged. more refined and aged.
Yeah,
his edges are clean.
I'm gonna look up a picture. I'll put two of them up. You know, and we'll look at the differences here. But off the top of my mind, it looks a little heavily inspired by the Peter Jackson.
Yeah. Definitely. The scenery, everything was definitely based in similar region of the world, similar style.
And I feel like, even if I may say so myself, it's not as like refined and formulated as like Peter Jackson, his artistic,
there wasn't the same kind of detail.
But like the shots and like the way the colors of the movie, the way it was balanced, it's all really, it had its own like almost unique look to it. It's not just your run of the mill, just like shot together, slapped together, and the 3D, I mentioned we saw it in 3D IMAX, and it looked pretty damn good. Like, it wasn't fuzzy, blurry, and half-assed. Like, the equipment they used was really well made equipment.
When that tree impaled the helicopter, it looked like it was coming at you. It was pretty good. Yeah.
So, the look and everything was great, and, to fast forward, Kong just fights a shit ton of
big lizard fucks.
Yeah, these big.
basically, like, they're about his size. They have big heads, like pointy heads. Yeah. They don't have rear legs. That was interesting.
They just have two hind legs, like a horse's hind legs, kind of. And like a long tail, like just a big, like,
pointy
chomper mouth.
Head.
Using the hands a lot, I'm sorry, but it's all good.
Good attention to detail. But that was funny, though, the naming part was, he's like, I just came up with the name off the top of my head.
Yeah, John C. Reilly.
Reilly, yeah.
Going into it, I was kind of iffy, like, come on, like, am I going to be able to take him seriously? But, I mean,
he didn't go overboard.
He didn't go overboard with his whole, like, stepbrother-y, Will Ferrell type of fucking humor.
He got his joke. I liked it. Actually,
he was a good comic relief.
I liked it, because they put it at the right points, and he was kind of cracked. Because he was been on the island for, 20-some years?
Yeah, and not to mention, John C. Reilly's character was the World War II veteran that crashed in the opening scene.
Japanese fellow.
And yeah, and he survived on the island, so that's who his character was. Yeah.
But, he didn't do a schlockly or anything. He, you know, like I said, he's a little cracked, so he makes jokes, but at the same time, he's just kind of like, I'm tired of being here, this place is hell, the only thing that's good is Kong and the people I live with.
Yeah, pretty much.
You know, and I want to go home.
Skull Island Islanders are just, you know, typical, you know, what you'd think they'd be similar. Not as
native people living.
They were a little more clean and, like, refined than they were in the Peter Jackson one.
Yeah,
it's not as,
not
like,
tribal,
ominous,
savage.
Yeah, they're more peaceful.
Yeah. Very set in their ways kind of people. Like, they don't want to do anything but respect their god that is Kong.
John C. Reilly lived on that. Oh, sorry to cut you off.
No, you got it.
But John C. Reilly's character, like, pretty much lived with those tribal people. And then that's when all the groups of explorers meet up with them. Because it's separated after the whole fight. It's Sam Jackson, the colonel, and his, like, military guys for the most part. And then it's like the scientists, the photographer,
the tracker,
and a couple other soldiers in that group.
They get separated.
So that group with the tracker, and then they meet up with John C. Reilly and the tribesmen, and he has a broken down, John C. Reilly has like a broken down combination of the planes that crashed, and he's trying to make a makeshift boat. So their whole plan is to get to the top of the island to get the military evacuation is going to take place in, like, the next 2 days.
And, well, on the other hand, Samuel's character kind of gets cracked himself.
Yeah,
he kind of takes Kong's attack on his group a whole personal offense, even though it was their fault. They were claiming they were bombing for seismic information, but really, I don't know if that was true or not. They kind of hinted that it was, maybe they were just trying to draw out whatever lived on the island in order to figure it out, in order to know how to defeat them, I guess, in some aspect. Mm-hmm. But yeah, so you can definitely tell, like, Samuel cracks, and he's more on that revenge kick, kind of like Moby did.
Right.
Like, I gotta kill my white whale, I gotta kill my Kong.
Yeah, it's the same thing, yeah. He kind of goes apeshit and has his own side plot to kill King Kong,
and go then, find the guns in another airship and, like, blow them up or try to kill them in general.
And John C. Reilly's character with the tracker group is, like, trying to tell everybody, like, because they eventually meet up and he's like, you guys can't do this. Like, it's not it's not the natural way things are supposed to happen. And then the scientists hop on and they're like, yeah, dude, we can't just kill this thing. Like,
they kind of reveal the major plot of Kong himself and the island, which is that him and his species, his family, are responsible for keeping the lizard creatures living underground. And that was the bombing was the claim that they kind of go off that hollow earth theory where there are parts of the earth where there are giant, like, ecosystems hidden underground. Like, and that's Minecraft. What the precedent is for this, is that Skull Island is, like, a place where they can all come out, and then there's the lizard guys who live underground, and, yeah, he keeps them underground.
Yeah.
And he's the last of his kind to do it, so he's, like, God to them, and the only way that they're going to live on the island, because without him, the lizards eat them all, and then the world.
And that's another good point, too, to segue into Kong being big as fuck. He's, like, 100 feet tall, almost. And
arms, like... gas tanker arm, you know, truck arms. Like, yeah, he's huge. He's
and it's character. Kind of explained just like it was in Peter Jackson Kong, where they explain, like, he's the last of his kind, you know, in the Peter Jackson one, that these are the skulls of past Kong, so that indicates he's obviously the last of his kind, or, you know, supposedly. And it kind of makes sense that in this version he's bigger, because it's based 35, 40 years later, after the original Kong that set, you know, the standard for Kong movies. So it makes sense that he's that much bigger, you know.
And they give a little quip to that, like, as he lives, he gets bigger. He's not
growing, right. So by the time he makes it into the next sequel in New York, he's going to be probably fucking 200 feet tall. But it makes sense. It's a good... It kind of explains it out in a fair enough...
What we've basically been leading up to, which is, like, continuing with the plot, basically, it kind of gives the precedent for... I feel like this version, and coinciding with Godzilla, they're kind of introducing the arcade version of Kong and, like, the Monster World version of Kong, where he's going to be huge, and he's going to work with Godzilla and everybody, you know, everybody else in the Japanese Monster World.
Yeah, because this movie is it's the second movie of the Universal Monsterverse, the first one being the Godzilla movie that came out a couple years ago. Mm. So it's obviously setting up for an Avengers-type monster universe of movies. So
Mothra, a turtle.
Right, you know, we could get Mothra in there. Hell, fucking Gigan and fucking Mecha Godzilla and versus fucking Song of Kong versus
who knows?
Andaro's. I'm not gonna say what I was gonna think of. But anywho, back to the movie pretty much wraps up with, you know, the fight against, should we kill him? Samuel Jackson trying to kill Kong. The good guys trying to stop him.
Kong ends up just splattering Samuel before he can actually set off his explosives, so that whole plan flushed. Kong fights the new big lizard that they woke up drawing Kong out with
there's
the explosions.
A mega fucking big skull crusher lizard.
An equally sized one to him, so it's the biggest threat.
Right. So they're then your final battle, pretty much the final battle is the rest of the humans left. Helping Kong with the boat they made. They had the gunner from one of the Mustang
That was a B-52
or B-52 was it?
On the front of it was a B-52 gunner pod. It was, so they were sitting there like, you know.
Yeah, the pod from the gunner
shit up. That was cool, too.
So they were assisting Kong by shooting the enemy skull crusher. That's what they were called in the movie. And Kong is simultaneously trying to cut. They do the nod to, like, that's what I was wondering. Is they going to do the dinosaur, like, jaw crush?
Rip open. He almost does it.
Because he does it in, you know, the original, obviously, in the Peter Jackson one. I think there's
ripping
even, like,
there's
a Japanese one, I think.
He does the same
The same one. And it's like, it's almost like his signature move. But he almost, like, attempts to do it.
You
then he fails.
Cracks, and then
he just, like, smashes the fucker into the side of the rock, you know. But the best fucking, like, part of that whole fight is the end of it when he finally fucking kills the guy.
Oh my god, dude, that was epic.
And he just shoves his hand in his fucking mouth and rips. It's like pretty much its upper, like, tract, tongue.
Most of the,
like,
organs involved, like, right here, plus, like, top of his stomach and stuff just comes
just
out,
like,
with the tongue all at once. Crazy, all that.
That
freaked me out, though. It was funny because so the photographer girl's kind of like the damsel in distress.
Yeah, because he's holding her the same time.
She falls while they're fighting. He thinks he's killed the monster, so he goes to grab her out of the water, kind of like, oh shit, oh shit. All of a sudden, the monster comes up, grabs him by the shoulder, wraps its tongue around it, and then, yeah, his tongue, his whole arm goes, like, into its mouth.
Yeah.
And I'm like, fuck, the girl's in his hand, in its mouth. And then all of a sudden, yeah, he just rips it, and all the organs come with. It's hilarious.
I don't know how they got away with that for a PG-13 movie.
Yeah, that was brutal as fuck.
Like, because it takes, like, comparing it again to the Peter Jackson Kong. I was watching that earlier, and I was like, it's kind of, like, tame. I mean, there's parts where shit gets smashed, and, you know...
But not that gore, like super shit getting
ripped
factor.
In half, like a lizard get ripped in half, excuse me. But it's like this one had a little bit more of just like, even the guy gets his arm ripped off by that bird thing.
That was funny too. They're having like this nice moment where they're like, all right, we're going to make it. And that one dude from the other group is standing on the front of the boat and he's like, wow, we might actually... All of a sudden, bird things come down, carry him off. He's screaming, ah! Fuck. And then all of a sudden, one of them dives in, slices his arm off, and they're like, well, he's fucked. Let's just keep going. One of the people is like, wait, we have to... What are we going to do? It's like, he's... They're all just like, he's fucking dead. Like, what do you want to do?
So the final fight was satisfying for the most part.
The whole movie was satisfying, actually.
It was. And that's pretty much all we can really do is talk about the plot. And then, Kong's just standing there, and it's like the end, you know.
My island, thump chest, you know.
And the ending was actually really nice, too, with John C. Reilly's character going home, like, fading into the credits.
Oh, that was nice, yeah. So
a little side plot.
You know, they do a little, like, last-minute act, you know, like, film where it's, like, done on an old camera.
A film reel, right, like an old 8mm film reel.
Him meeting his wife and his son that he... didn't even really think we were alive or be like just
because he mentions in the movie they're like what are you gonna do like when you get home or whatever and he's like I just want to see if I can find my wife and my son for one last meet them just one last time
or just not once. Even interested if they want me to know me or not I just want to see them
so it's kind of it was a nice good little ending.
A little heart clencher at the end. It was nice.
Right.
Nice way to end it.
And, Kong, right before that, Kong standing just there. Like, so it's like, what's next for the big ape? So it was great. I not much else to talk about without nitpicking straight down in details. Like I said,
I liked it because just got back. Compared to the Peter Jackson version, it was simple and it was to the friggin' point.
It was cut down
monster
perfectly.
Monster fights. Crazy creatures that wanted to murder the living hell out of you. I was one disappointment. We never got to see those giant ants. He mentions like these ants that sound like birds, and they hear them.
So I wonder if that's going to be part of the bonus, like cut content.
Probably.
That's some look. Because there was one creature that you didn't get to see.
There were ants. Apparently, they were huge and
like tree dwellers.
Yeah, he's sitting there like with his pistol and his samurai sword out. Like I hear ants, I'm freaking out.
So, other than that, final thoughts on the movie? Would I recommend it? Yes.
Definitely.
It's a popcorn thriller. That's not much else you can say. It's not as heavy on the story as Peter Jackson.
Don't expect to see a real story, but there shouldn't be. It's Kong. It's
right.
Smash.
And I guess one
destruction.
Other...
Don't add a story.
It is.
Don't add too much BS to it.
It's a perfect action thriller. It's like Predator meets Apocalypse Now meets every King Kong movie ever made, for the most part.
If you like Vietnam-style movies and stuff, basically that's what this movie is.
It's kind of
like, take the monsters out, and this is a Vietnam movie. It felt exactly like that.
Mm-hmm.
And, like I said, if you just take the monsters out, it's Vietnam.
So, I really greatly liked it. It's probably... One of the best movies I've seen just in theaters lately. I don't go to many movies, but it's one of the better ones where I felt satisfied with my, $16 goddamn dollars I spent, plus 16 more goddamn dollars for a popcorn and soda, but that's a whole separate debate. But for Kong, thumbs up. If I had to give it the toasty review rating, I'm going to expand it from 5 to 10. I'm going to give that a solid 8.5.
Toasties.
Yes. So, really, really well done movie. Sets precedent for the next entry in the King Kong.
Has its moments.
And
funny.
Universal Monsterverse. Great, comic relief, good action thriller, explosions, guns, monsters, violence. Samuel Jackson almost says motherfucker, but he gets
so
killed.
Close. Yeah.
I was wondering, is he going to say motherfucker?
That is one little side note. It does have good characters. I enjoyed them all. So I'm glad to see and the lot of death. So,
that's the King Kong, a lot of death. King Kong Skull Island, a lot of death.
Be prepared.
So yes, great movie. If you like these toasty movie reviews, it's a first. Let us know. I'm down to do it more often when we see movies in the future. But
we'll spend our $15 to give you guys enjoyment and find out if any movies are good.
Sure. So let us know. Always enjoy the feedback. But until next time, comrades, this is Drewski.
Briggs.
Yellow Buckets crew. Peace out. Enjoy the evening. Go watch some movies.